going to ask that we bow our heads and close our eyes. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for that song. Thank you so much for giving us that desire to be used by you for this dying world. Speak through us, Lord. Speak through me. May the words that you have to speak through me feed this congregation, so that when they leave this place, they can feed the world. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Good afternoon, church. Good afternoon, church. You'll have to forgive me. I don't know if any of you have ever gone to a graduation service at Crawford Edmonds Academy. But whenever I get up to stand, I love getting up to stand after many other people have spoken, because I can say all protocols observed and continue with the service. So, all protocols observed. I'd like to thank Pastor Anderson and Pastor Nichols for allowing me to carry this burden of preaching the Word of God today. I'd like to thank the previous pastors in this series. Haven't you enjoyed the series?
Yes.
Are We There Yet? It's the title of the series, for those of you who did not know. And I believe it began with Pastor Feeling, preached on the power of one. Pastor Glenn De Silva preached the second week on sitting in the shade or serving in the sun. And then last week, Pastor Frank DeLerba gave us the message, the cry of the lost. Are we there yet? When I first heard the theme, I don't know about you, but I grew up hearing, are we there yet? And it just reminds me of annoying children in the back seat of a minivan on the way to a destination, and all they can ask is, are we there yet? Okay, so it's not just me alone. But as I contemplated more on the theme, I realized, okay, you know, this is not about annoying children. It's about church. Are we there yet? And the more I contemplated, the more I thought about it, I said, this sounds like a blind church that doesn't realize how close they are to their destination. Are we there yet? Do we have the right influential members yet? Have we baptized enough people yet? Are we perfect yet? Are we better than the other church yet? But then I realized, no, I can't be that. This is Toronto East. It's Toronto East Seventh-day Adventist Church. So this theme has to do with where we are and where we're going. As we prepare to move into our new home, are we a community yet? Better yet, are we a Christ-centered community yet? Are we ready to add to our community? Are we ready for Chinese families? Are we ready for Japanese families? Are we ready for Korean families? Are we ready to be the Christ-centered church that welcomes the entire community around us? Or are we just occupying a spot that we purchased? It looked good. We had the money. We bought it. In my humble attempt to allow God to speak through me today, I put it to you that in order to answer the question, are we there yet? The church needs to be soaking wet. Amen. I'll explain. Soaking wet. Okay, let's get into the word. At the beginning of Ephesians chapter 3, Paul explains that by God's grace he's been appointed to be the apostle to the Gentiles. Understood? in his account, he refers to the mystery of Christ. And in verse 6, he says, this mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel. The Gentiles, through the gospel, are heirs to the gospel, heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, and sharers together in the promise in Jesus Christ. I'm going to give you 3 points today. I'm going to make it very simple, very down to earth. Point number one, every outsider has the right to worship inside. Everyone outside these walls has the right to worship inside. The conversion of the Gentiles to the faith of Christ was a great mystery, a delightful mystery that we ought to praise the Lord for. Amen. Who would have imagined that nations and people who had been so long in the dark, persons who had been so far from God, could now be adopted as God's children? Church, can we learn not to turn away the worst of people? Is it hard for us not to turn away the drug addicts or the drug dealers? Is it impossible for us not to turn away those alcoholics or even those convicted, which means they did it, convicted criminals, murderers? Can we learn not to turn away those people? After all, we don't turn away those who are addicted to lying. Hey, Pastor? We don't turn away those who are addicted to stealing. They're in our church. After all, the church may not be full of alcoholics, but we sure do have sexaholics. We do have adulterers. We do have fornicators, but we don't turn them away. They're in our church. The church is full of not just murderers, but mass murderers, serial killers who use their tongue to murder and to kill those around them. We don't turn them away. Church, can we reach a point where we do not turn away the worst of people? After all, I believe strongly nothing is too hard for divine grace to do. No person so unworthy that God won't choose to show them grace. Lest we forget, we are part of the nations which in times past were foreigners and strangers. We lived in gross idolatry, but by God's grace now, hallelujah, we have the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? Paul goes on to say in verse 7-9 that he became a servant of the gospel by God's grace. And although he is the least of all the Lord's people, and by the way, Paul at this time was the chief of the apostles, but he calls himself the least among the people of God because before he was the chief apostle, he was the chief persecutor. So he sees himself and he humbles himself as the least of the people of God. And he says he became the servant of the gospel by God's grace. And although he's the least of all the Lord's people, you know what? Let me pause here for a moment. You'll have to forgive me. Those whom God puts in a position, let me repeat that. Those whom God honors and places in honorable, high positions. He humbles. And he makes them see themselves lowly in their own eyes. Now some of you may be saying, no, but I know some people who are in high position who are not humble. But I need to repeat that. Those whom God puts in positions, not man puts in position. You see, God does not vote for popularity. God looks at the heart, and whom he exalts, he humbles. If you are in a high position and you are not humble, I pray and ask that you seek for it. Ask him for it. And if you think you are humble and others around you don't, you're not there yet. In verse 10 and 11, Paul continues by saying that his, and that's God he's speaking about, God's intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. That's the angelic host, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ our Lord. And what was God's eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ? John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17 clearly tells us, for God so loved the world that what? He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever did what? Believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to what? Condemn the world. That wasn't his purpose, but that the world, the Gentiles, the Jews, the Samaritans, everyone in our community, but that the world through him might be saved. That's our duty, church. It is our duty as a church to show Christ to the world outside these walls, outside our cultures, so that they might be saved. Are we there yet? You can agree with me that since Paul's time through to present day, the church has had some serious issues. And we have undergone some major adjustments. And those who were here during Sabbath school, you would have seen the little skit of the Christians and dealing with the Aboriginals and the Aboriginals responding to the fact that these same Christians raped our culture. Stole our land. All in the name of Jesus. At one point, the church became like Saul. And we began persecuting those who we were supposed to be saving. In fact, some would argue that the church hasn't even left that point yet. Persecuting those who we're supposed to be saving because they don't speak like us. They don't dress like us. They don't look like us. When, let's face it, church, the truth is, they don't fake it like us. Our call as a church is to preach Christ and his gift of salvation to all who would hear it. Amen?
Yes.
Not just poor people. Yes. Not just poor people. Because they have need for material things. But we ought to preach to the rich as well. Because all of us are in need of grace. Are we there yet though? Are we ready to church the rich? Are we ready to appeal to those who don't need any material things, but rather need a community? They need a family. They need a Toronto East that truly cares about their soul salvation and their well-being and not just their pockets. Are we there yet? In California, there's some huge redwood trees and they're amazing. They're said to be the largest living things on earth. The tallest trees in the world. They're famous for cars driving section of the tree trunk. Some of those trees reach a height of 300 feet and are more than 2,000 years old. You would think that trees that large would have a tremendous root system, reaching down 100, 200, or even 300 feet into the earth, but that's not the case. In fact, redwoods have a very shallow root system. Their roots only go down about 5 or 6 feet. The roots of these trees are, however, intertwined with each other. And although they go down only 5 or 6 feet, sometimes the root of one tree extends up to 100 feet from the trunk. And they're tied in with the other trees, interlocked, so that when the storms come and the winds blow, the redwoods still stand. With an interlocking root system, they support and they sustain each other. They need one another to survive. Church, so do we. Point number two. This is point number 2 of 3. The church needs members to need members to survive. Let me repeat that. The church needs members to need members to survive. You see, God has given us a church, which is the body of Christ on earth. Amen? When one is baptized into Christ, one is baptized into the body of Christ. Through Christ, we are bound together in a community of faith. Belonging to Christ, we belong to each other. Through Christ, God has made us a family, a community of faith. This is our God-given support system. A mix of people with different personalities, different backgrounds, different ideas, who might never hang out together, except that they have one thing in common. We love Jesus.
Amen.
And in one way or another, we have been transformed by his amazing love and mercy. And when the church is working right, it becomes a place where our old nature and our old instincts begin to die. And we start thinking completely different about the people around us. People who we might never have associated with before, suddenly become our brothers and our sisters. And we find ourselves wanting we want more and more of those type of people in our community. Our community becomes a place of love, a place of service, and a place where people experience the transforming power of Jesus Christ as he works in their lives. See, the Bible tells us the very first community of believers, Acts chapter 2, verse 44, they gathered together on a regular basis for worship, for prayer, for study, and fellowship. And the Bible says that all that believed were together. And in the first century, the first part of Christianity, it wasn't easy to follow Christ. It was rough. Persecution was rampant, but the early believers believed in Jesus. And they were bound together into a fellowship, into a community. They needed each other. They leaned on each other. It isn't all easy right now. It isn't easy, Pastor. It isn't easy, congregation. It isn't easy even now to follow Christ. Okay, sure, times are not necessarily rough. And no, we don't have persecution. But we do face discouragement. We face temptation. We face sin. We face apathy. We face failure. We face materialism. We face unbelieving family and friends. We face doubts We face rejection. We face unanswered questions. Or we are just plain busy. We just don't have the time. We face so many obstacles in our desire to live for the Lord, but God has not left us on our own. He hasn't left you on your own to run this race. He has given us each other. In the New Testament, there's no Lone Rangers. There's no Lone Ranger Christians. Believers needed each other, and God expected them to be there for each other. He expects you to be there for me. He expects me to be there for you. Church, we need each other. And God has ordained that we be a part of each other's faith. Hebrews 10 verse 25 tells us not to give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. Mercy. But let us encourage one another. You see, God has a purpose for putting each and every one of us together. There's a famous poem. I'm not sure if you know it, if you've heard it. It's by Joan Boyes. And she penned the famous lyrics, "No man is an island, no man stands alone. Each man's joy is joy to me, each man's grief is my own. We need one another, so I will defend each man as my brother, each man as my friend. I saw the people gather, I heard the music start, the song that they were singing is ringing in my heart. No man is an island, way out in the blue. We all look to the one above for our strength to renew. When I help my brother, then I know that I plant the seed of friendship that will never die." We need each other. I didn't grow up in the church. I was actually baptized in about grade 9. My mom was a Seventh-day Adventist, but she wasn't practicing for the early parts of our young years. Is that okay for me to say, Mom? Now, if my mom wasn't in church today, I would say how much I admired her. When everyone else around seemed to be tipsy at our house parties, my mom, no matter how much beer she drank, she was never, ever tipsy. If my mom wasn't here at church, I would say, of three. Most importantly, church. The church needs to be a place where people meet Jesus. John chapter 4 begins with Jesus leaving Judea on his way to Galilee. And beginning with verse 4, that's John 4 verse 4, it says, he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. Jacob's what was there? Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. Where did he sit down by the well? He sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water. Let's pause there for a moment. Jesus is at the well. Jesus is at the well. Jesus, this is the forgiver of all sins. This is the friend of sinners. This is the way for those who are lost. This is the truth in a world full of lies. Jesus, the way, the life for those staring death in the face. Jesus, the great I am, is at the well. And a Samaritan woman, a thirsty Samaritan woman, comes to the well and meets Jesus there. Jesus then speaks to her and says, will you give me a drink? And from John 4, verse 9 to 23, Jesus' discourse with this woman draws her attention to the fact that she is in need of salvation. And in verse 25 and 26, the conversation ends with the Samaritan woman saying, I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he'll explain everything to us. And Jesus declares, I am he. Amen. Toronto East SDA Church. If we are to be an effective church in our present location and in our new location, we need to be soaking wet. Yes. We need to be the well. We need to be that place where Samaritans, Jews, men, women, girls, boys, Asians, Africans, Indians, West Indians, Europeans, North Americans, South Americans, black people, white people, yellow people, red people. We need to be that well where everyone can come to meet Jesus. Amen. Are we there yet? Just as Jesus was at the well, let Jesus always be found at Toronto East. Amen. Just as Jesus reached out to the Samaritan with open arms, let us always, with outstretched arms, reach out to our surrounding community and let Jesus, through us, begin the conversation. Jesus spoke to her. Jesus initiated the conversation. Let us be the well where Jesus is. And just as the Samaritan woman kept asking Jesus questions and Jesus kept giving her answers, let Toronto East be the place where the confused come to get answers. John chapter 4, verse 39 to 41 says, many of the Samaritans from that town believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I did, she said. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 days. 2 days. And because of this, because of Jesus, who was at the well, because of his words, many more became believers. 2 days. How many weeks do we usually have crusades? Three, four? 2 days. Jesus was with them, and many more became believers. Are we there yet? Church, I'd like to invite you to get soaking wet. Let us be the place where Jesus resides. Let's be the place where Jesus reaches a lost world. Let's be the church soaking wet. At this time, I'd like to make two appeals. First, there are some of us who need to move from being observers of the community to a place where we embrace the people of the community. A place where we're not just coming to church, but we need to come to a place where we call each other brothers and sisters. It may be that we need to take a step towards membership. And we need to begin speaking of our church as our church and not just your church or the church. It's a very significant decision to embrace a community of believers as your own and see yourself on a journey together. If you haven't taken that step, I encourage you to speak with Pastor Anderson or Pastor Nichol or any of the elders of this church. If you haven't taken that step, speak to someone you trust about how you can be a part of this family of God. And my second appeal is for those of us who have embraced this community as our family, but there's room to grow. For us, the challenge may be to take our involvement to another level. Maybe we need to step it up a notch. Maybe we need to see ourselves as not just churchgoers, but also fellow workers. A great analogy is a dinner table. And as someone said, both dinner guests and the families enjoy the same meal. Understood? But the difference is, at the end of that meal, family members also do the dishes. You see, it's appropriate to be a dinner guest for a while. But there comes a time when it's appropriate to get up and wash the dishes. Perhaps there are areas that God has laid on your heart as a member of the Toronto East Seventh-day Adventist Church where you would love to dive into community and service, but you just haven't dared to yet. True community doesn't happen overnight. But when each person in the family, each person begins to wrestle with their own place in the church and takes a step toward a deeper relationship, community grows. People who would have never normally hung out together begin to love each other and even lay down their lives for each other for one simple reason. Jesus laid down his life for us. I invite you, church, to please stand with me. And those of you who my first appeal spoke to, you want to be a part of this community, I invite you to come through the aisles and to come forward. And for those of you who my second appeal spoke to, you are a member of this church, but you know in your heart God has been speaking to you about getting involved, putting your foot and your hands in the mud and dirt and getting involved with the church, I invite you also to come forward. And my third and last appeal is for all the brothers and sisters of Toronto East. Look around you. You're not standing alone. But if it is your desire to continue to support your brothers and sisters here, as we are here at Channel 9 and as we move into our new location, if it is your desire to continue to support your church, I invite you forward. Thank you. thank you so much for your word. Thank you so much for sending your son, for coming to live, to die, and even more so, to raise, be raised for our salvation. Lord, I ask in a special way that you will continue to ignite the fire that is in our bones. Continue to encourage us not to just to want to worship you, but to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we don't want to drink the same old water. We don't want our cup to be stagnant. We want to go out into the community and preach your word so that every family that comes to this place, they don't see me, but they see Jesus through me. It is our prayer, Lord, not that we shine, but that you shine through us. It is our prayer, Lord, not that we speak, that you speak through us. When we go to our workplace, speak through us. When we're driving on the road, speak through us. When we're on the bus, Lord, speak through us. When we're in the shopping mall, when we're buying groceries, every day, all day, speak to us. For your sake. Thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity to speak with you and to come before your throne boldly, knowing full well that you've already begun the great work within us. Despite everything that was said to today,